Hello friends, welcome to Pathology Basics. Today we'll be discussing a very important topic, that is ischemic heart disease. Ischemic heart disease is comprised of myocardial infarction and angina pectoris, apart from other acute coronary syndromes. We'll be discussing them in detail from a pathology point of perspective. So what are ischemic heart diseases? They are basically pathophysiologically related syndromes, and they happen because there is an imbalance between the myocardial oxygen supply or myocardial blood supply and the demand for oxygenated blood. Ischemic heart disease can present clinically as one of the following syndromes. It can present as angina, which may be stable or unstable. Stable angina basically results from an increase in myocardial oxygen demand, and there is some sort of stenosis, some form of stenosis of the coronary arteries, because of which enough blood does not reach the myocardium. It is not associated with plaque disruption, it is just narrowing of the coronary arteries that leads to improper blood supply to the myocardium, which leads to pain. That is called stable angina. Unstable angina, on the other hand, is caused by disruption of the plaque that has formed. It may be in the coronaries, it may be superimposed on the atherosclerotic plaque. That plaque gets disrupted, and it leads to severe but transient reductions in the coronary flow. It leads to transient pain. That is called unstable angina. Myocardial infarction, what happens is there is thrombotic occlusion of the coronary arteries, and this results in necrosis of the myocardial muscle. That is called myocardial infarction. It is an irreversible change. Sudden cardiac death. Sudden cardiac death may happen because of severe myocardial ischemia. This may lead to fatal ventricular arrhythmias. Myocardial infarction and sudden cardiac death are together called acute coronary syndromes. What are the causes of myocardial infarction and angina? It is atherosclerosis, which leads to obstruction of the coronary vessels. It may be embolus, which has come from a distal site, like deep-vein thrombosis. It may be inflammation of the myocardial vessels, or may be due to vascular spasm due to various causes. Let's see the epidemiology of myocardial disease, that is ischemic heart disease. It is seen most commonly, nearly 65 or 55% of the cases happen after the age of 65. It is seen more commonly in men. Women are protected from MI during their reproductive years because of estrogen. In the postmenopausal age group, the estrogen production gradually declines, and this leads to an increased risk of coronary artery disease in postmenopausal women. Unfortunately, even hormone replacement is not protective. There has been great advances in the field of cardiology and MI in particular. The death rate has declined. We now know the risk factors. The most common risk factors for MI are smoking, blood cholesterol levels, and hypertension. Smoking is a very important risk factor for MI. High cholesterol levels as well as hypertensive changes all lead to an increased risk of myocardial infarction. Apart from this, diabetes mellitus is another important risk factor. Now, maintenance of normal blood glucose levels in diabetic patients, as well as control of metabolic syndrome by exercise, this has all lead to decrease in mortality rates due to MI. There also have been diagnostic and therapeutic advances, such as medications are now available which lower cholesterol levels, such as statins, use of prophylactic aspirin. There has been great therapy advances, like thrombolysis is now available for MI, percutaneous transluminal coronary angioplasty, and consequent keeping of stents in the coronaries, and even coronary artery bypass grafting has advanced a lot, which has decreased the death rate. In case of arrhythmias, to control that, left ventricular assist devices implantable defibrillators and cardiac resynchronization with pacemakers, all these are important advances which have lowered the death rate due to MI. Let's see the pathogenesis. Pathogenesis rests on three main points. First is vascular occlusion, then acute plaque change, and this may be supplemented through vasospasm. So occlusion can happen of any of the main coronary arteries. As you know that coronary arteries are end arteries, they supply a particular region of the myocardium, and in order to develop collaterals it requires a lot of time. So sudden obstruction of a coronary leads to myocardial infarction of the area supplied by that vessel. Three main vessels chiefly are the LAD, or the left anterior descending, LCX, or the left circumflex, and RCA means the right coronary artery. Which area is supplied by these vessels we'll see later on. If there is a lesion obstructing greater than 75% of the cross-sectional area of the vessel, it leads to coronary artery disease. This is the threshold after which ischemia precipitates, and initially the ischemia is seen after exercise because the myocardial demand increases and it leads to angina. If there is obstruction of more than 90% of the cross-sectional area of the vessel, it can lead to angina even at rest. The occlusion that has happened, it may be increased by acute plaque change. This is initiated by the rupture, erosion, ulceration, or fissuring into that atherosclerotic lesion. Vasospasm, it further worsens the lumen, that is lumen is narrowed further, and this happens because of mediators released from the platelets. Let's come to the first syndrome, which is angina pectoris. Angina pectoris is paroxysmal and recurrent attacks of chest pain. Chest pain in heart, associated with the heart, is usually substernal or precordial. Angina is usually transient, 15 to 15 minutes, that is 15 seconds to 15 minutes, and this is actually insufficient to induce necrosis. It is just that the myocardial demand is increasing and it is leading to stress of that muscle and leading to pain. There is no necrosis over there. Angina is of four types. It's of three types: stable angina, Prinz metal variant angina, and unstable or crescendo angina. Stable angina, all of these anginas have different causes to it. Stable angina is, it happens in the background of narrowing of the coronary arteries due to atherosclerosis, but the pain is precipitated by physical activity, emotions, or psychological stress. And the pain is the one typically described as heartburn. It is deep, poorly localized, and squeezing or burning sensation is there. The pain of stable angina is relieved by rest as the myocardial demand for oxygen goes down, or it may also be relieved by giving vasodilators such as nitroglycerin or calcium channel blockers, because they dilate the blood vessels and so enough blood can reach. Prinz metal angina, it is a uncommon form of angina. It is not caused due to luminal narrowing, rather it is caused due to spasm, and hence the attacks of pain are unrelated to physical activity. It is not related to heart rate or to blood pressure even, and it will not be relieved by rest, but it will be relieved only by vasodilators. Unstable angina or crescendo angina, this form is prolonged angina, that is prolonged pain more than 20 minutes. It is severe and it is described as frank pain precipitated by lower levels of physical activity, and this form of pain happens even at rest. It is basically caused by disruption of atherosclerotic plaque. So what happens if angina is not controlled, vasodilators are not given, or the plaque or the atherosclerotic plaque occludes nearly 90% of the lumen? Myocardial infarction happens. So what happens when the vessel is occluded? within seconds of occlusion of the vessel, the ATP depletion starts. In less than 2 minutes, there is loss of contractility. That is, first the function of the myocardium goes down. When the ATP is reduced to 50% of the normal in 10 minutes, it reaches up to 10% of the original levels in 40 minutes. In 20 to 40 minutes, there is irreversible injury, and later on there is microvascular injury. So the crucial time for intervention is 20 to 30 minutes of onset of myocardial infarction if appropriate measures are taken within 20 to 30 minutes. Then myocardium can be salvaged, irreversible damage can be prevented. So this is a timeline of myocardial infarction. You can see in the first paragraph or in the first figure that initially, as the vessel is occluded, first the ATP goes down and slowly lactate, it starts rising. This happens because of accumulation of lactic acid. You can see in the second one, that is within 20 minutes or within 20 to 30 minutes, is a reversible phase. In the reversible phase, the myocardium can be salvaged, it can be protected. Then as time passes, there is accumulation of the dead myocardium. After 20 to 30 minutes, the myocardium can be salvaged, but as time goes on, the amount of myocardium that can be salvaged also goes down. So which area of the myocardium is potentially at risk after obstruction of the coronaries? For this, we need to understand that the vessels that supply the myocardium, they supply from outside to the inside. That is, they supply from pericardium to the endocardium. Therefore, the innermost layer, that is the endocardium, is at maximum risk for ischemia. This is apart from the innermost endocardium, 1 mm, which is not perfused by the coronaries but rather supplied by the blood that is there in the chambers. The myocardial perfusion pattern, as I told, is from epicardium to the endocardium, and except 1 mm of the innermost endocardium, it is supplied, which is supplied by blood in the heart chamber. So the injury to the heart muscle, it occurs first in the subendocardial zone. As ischemia progresses, what happens is the endocardial zone, which has infarcted, now the ischemia or myocardial infarction moves through the myocardium in the form of a wave front, and it involves more and more of the myocardium, and ultimately it becomes transmural, and nearly half of the thickness of the myocardium is infarcted in 2 to 3 hours of the onset of ischemia, and within 6 hours it becomes transmural. As you can see over here, the endocardial, in the second one, in 2 hours you can see there is an endocardial subendocardial infarct, and within 24 hours it has involved transmurally. As I told you, the blood vessels or the coronaries supplying the heart are end arteries, and depending on which vessel is blocked, that particular area of the heart will be involved. The left anterior descending artery, it supplies blood to the front and bottom of the left ventricle and the front of the septum. Therefore, LAD, which is most commonly affected, if that artery is affected, these areas of the heart will be involved. The left circumflex artery, it supplies blood to the left atrium and back of the left ventricle, and the right coronary artery, it supplies blood to the right atrium, right ventricle, bottom portion of the left ventricle and back of the septum. This figure is showing which area of the myocardium, or rather the ventricles, will be involved if the arteries affected, depending on the artery affected, and whether the infarcts are neural or transmural, depending on the cause. So first, if you look at the transmural infarcts, this area of the myocardium, that is the left ventricle and this portion of the septum, is affected. If left anterior descending artery is involved, this area of the myocardium is affected. If the left circumflex is involved, and this is the area affected when the right coronary artery is involved. Now, in case of left anterior descending artery, if there is reperfusion, that is through various measures that are taken, then we are able to salvage most of the myocardium and a subendocardial infarct may remain. This is the kind of infarction that is seen in case of global hypotension. That is, all the arteries, they are not completely obstructed, they are somewhat patent, and therefore there is a global subendocardial infarct. And if there are small emboli that are obstructing various tiny arteries, not the whole bigger coronary arteries, but inside the branches of bigger coronaries, then you get small micro infarcts as seen over here. How do we diagnose myocardial infarction? Myocardial infarction is diagnosed on the basis of three things. First, typical clinical features we see. Clinical features are not seen in diabetic patients. In those cases, we call it as a silent infarct. On the basis of clinical symptoms, then we go for certain laboratory tests for detecting myocardial proteins, and we also do an ECG. What are the typical clinical features or clinical symptoms of the patients with myocardial infarction? Of course, we know there's chest pain, and the chest pain is prolonged, lasting for more than 30 minutes, and it is described as crushing, stabbing or squeezing pain. The pulse of the patient is weak and rapid. Patient experiences diaphoresis, that is profuse sweating. Patient may have nausea and vomiting, that is because of secondary involvement of the vagal nerve. Dyspnea may be there. This may happen because impaired contractility of the heart may lead to pulmonary congestion and edema. And silent infarct is seen in diabetic patients. In diabetic patients, there is neuropathy, and the disease may be only discovered after ECG or by laboratory tests. Now, detecting myocardial proteins in blood is based on the principle that after severe ischemia, there is irreversible damage to the cardiac myocytes. When the myocytes are damaged, there is loss of integrity of the sarcolemmal membranes, and therefore certain intracellular molecules may leak out of the necrotic cells. Detecting these macromolecules is the basis of tests for myocardial infarction. As you can see over here, molecules such as CKMB and troponins are leaking out after damage by infarction, and these are then detected in the serum. The molecules that we most commonly detect or use to diagnose myocardial infarction, they include troponin I and CKMB. Myoglobin is another molecule, but myoglobin is very non-specific because it is released by any muscle damage, any skeletal muscle damage. The most sensitive and specific markers are the troponins, because troponins are not produced by any other type of muscle except cardiac muscle. CKMB has various isoforms such as CKMB, CKMM and CKBP. Out of that, CKMB is quite specific for cardiac muscle. If you can see in this graph, it shows after how much time the molecules start rising and when they come back to the baseline. If you can see the red graph of myoglobin, it is rising immediately after infarction. It peaks around 4 hours and comes back to normal within, let's say, 15 to 20 hours. CKMB starts rising 2 to 3 hours after. It peaks around 16 to 17 hours and then still remains raised even after a week. If we talk about troponin I, it starts getting raised around 4 hours and it peaks after about 20 to 22 hours, and it remains high even after that. One point I would like to make over here: if we talk about reinfarction, In case of reinfarction, CKMB is better than troponin I because troponin I remains high after a long time after the first infarction. Therefore, you cannot distinguish between the first infarction and a reinfarction. CKMB goes down after about 3 to 4 days and then it rises again in case of a reinfarction. These are the ECG changes on the basis of which we can diagnose MI. Of course, it is not comprehensive. I am showing the most common ECG lead changes. How it happens within minutes, the PQRS T wave that we see normally, within minutes there is a peak T wave. Within minutes to hours, there is progressive elevation of the ST segment, as you can see over here. Within hours or days, there is the loss of R wave and there is Q wave formation. After that, the T wave becomes inverted. Then there is normalization, but still the Q wave persists. So this is what happens after infarction. We diagnose MI on the basis of this ST segment elevation most commonly. What are the complications after myocardial infarction? First is stunned myocardium. Stunned myocardium is basically loss of contractility of the myocardium, and this is prolonged. It is a state of prolonged cardiac failure, and this happens because of short-term ischemia. It recovers on its own after several days. Hibernation is a state in which the myocardium, after chronic sublethal ischemia, it enters into a state of lowered metabolism and function, that is called hibernation. After a significant portion of the myocardium becomes infarcted, there may be contractile dysfunction of the myocardium. This will lead to ventricular failure with hypotension, and there will be back pressure changes, like there will be pulmonary edema and respiratory impairment. The pump failure, severe pump failure, is called cardiogenic shock, and this will happen in 10 to 15% of the patients. The cardiac muscle, it may show arrhythmias. Arrhythmias can be of various types, as I mentioned over here. There may be rupture. Rupture of the ventricle usually happens when there is transmural necrosis of the ventricle. Femoral rupture most commonly happens 2 to 4 days after MI, after which coagulative necrosis, and there is considerable damage to the myocardial tissue and the myocardium becomes very weak. The most common site for ventricular rupture is the ventricular free wall rupture, or there may be rupture of the septum depending on which area is infarcted the most, or there may be rupture of papillary muscles here. There may be aneurysms. Aneurysms are again of two types, true and false aneurysms. True aneurysms are those that are bound by, aneurysm is basically dilatation. True aneurysms are said when the aneurysms or the dilated chamber is bound by thinned out myocardium, that is left off. What happens is when the heart beats, that particular area paradoxically bulges during the systole, as you can see over here. Whereas in comparison, false aneurysm, there is a complete rupture of the myocardium and the blood is contained into the cardiac cavity by pericardium. Pericarditis or restless syndrome, fibrinous pericarditis develops following a transmural infarct because of underlying inflammation. Infarct may expand. This is because of disproportionate stretching, thinning and dilatation of the infarct region. Or there may be neural thrombus formation. When the contractility of the ventricle is lost, the blood accumulates inside the chambers, stasis happens, there may be endocardial damage, and this can foster neural thrombus formation, as you can see over here. Of course, if the papillary muscles are damaged or there is infarction that is related to the valves directly, it may lead to incompetence of the valves. long-term changes that are seen after obstruction of the coronaries is called chronic ischemic heart disease, or we also call it as ventricular remodeling. It's very important to note that this concept of ventricular remodeling is associated with the remaining non-damaged or non-infarcted myocardium and not the infarcted myocardium. The non-infarcted segments of the ventricles, they'll undergo hypertrophy and dilatation. This is to compensate for the infarcted myocardium, which cannot contract. Initially, this hypertrophy is beneficial, that the contractile power of the heart increases. However, this may be overwhelmed by dilatation, because dilatation will increase again the oxygen demand and it can exacerbate ischemia. So this is called chronic ischemic heart disease or ventricular remodeling. So this is the summary of coronary artery disease, what we have studied till now. There is some sort of coronary artery disease. It may lead to myocardial ischemia. Myocardial ischemia may lead to sudden cardiac death if it is severe, or myocardial ischemia may convert to chronic ischemic heart disease. Or coronary artery disease, as we know, there may be acute plaque change which may lead to myocardial ischemia of increasing severity. There are various changes, such as there may be healing of the infarct, there may be ventricular remodeling, or there is hypertrophy of the viable muscle. Ultimately, it leads to congestive heart failure, and if there is some acute change, it may lead to sudden cardiac death. So this is the summary of what we have seen till now. Let's see the morphology. Pathology is all about what we see grossly and microscopically. So grossly, if infarct is less than 12 hours old, we may not be able to make it out grossly. However, if we use a dye called as triphenyl tetrazolium chloride, then it is possible to highlight the area of necrosis. The viable muscle, it appears red, whereas the infarcted one here, as marked by an arrow, it appears gray. This, the principle of this is the viable myocardium. In the viable myocardium, lactate dehydrogenase is preserved, and this stain marks it red because of the presence of lactate dehydrogenase. And in the infarcted myocardium, this LDH is lost. Therefore, that area does not appear red. So these are the microscopic changes seen. We will see pictures wherever available. We will try to make it more interesting. The earliest change seen is, of course, not gross. We cannot see under the microscope within half an hour, but the earliest change is seen under the electron microscope, where we see mitochondrial swelling. Right, so if you can see in this figure, the mitochondria have swollen. It is marked by an arrow. So earliest change seen electron microscopically in myocardial infarction is mitochondrial swelling. Then we can see within half hour to 4 hours, irreversible injury starts. Again, we cannot see anything grossly, but the earliest light microscopic change seen is waviness of the fibers at the border. If you can see, this is light microscopic change. On the right are the normal cardiac myocytes, and on the left you can see wavy cardiac myocytes. Electron microscopically, we start seeing mitochondrial amorphous densities within half to 4 hours, like here. Okay, the arrows, small arrows, are marking electron densities inside the mitochondria. Then after 4 hours, coagulation necrosis can be seen, and neutrophilic infiltrate starts coming in. Within 1 to 3 days, we can see brisk interstitial infiltrate of neutrophils. As you can see over here, there is coagulative necrosis of the muscles. You can see that the muscles have completely necrosed, the nuclei are no longer seen, and the cell borders have become fuzzy, and there is a lot of neutrophilic infiltrate. Within 3 to 7 days, now phagocytosis of the dead muscle starts, and this continues until 7 to 10 days. In 7 to 10 days, there is well-developed phagocytosis. As you can see, the necrosed muscles are completely digested by phagocytes over here. Within 10 to 14 days, there is granulation tissue formation and new blood vessels come in and collagen starts getting deposited. Right, you can see over here. Within 2 to 8 weeks, there is within 2 to 8 weeks and till 2 months, there is dense collagen scar formation, that is healing of the infarct is seen, as you can see over here. So what do we learn? We see from the changes seen microscopically and grossly that time is myocardial. That is, myocardium can be preserved if interventions are done within a certain time frame, that is within 30 minutes. Within 30 minutes, we can prevent irreversible injury. After that also, some amount of myocardium can be salvaged if early therapy is given, like thrombolysis or angioplasty. So we can achieve it by thrombolysis, PTCA or percutaneous transluminal angioplasty and stent placement, or by CABG. How does reperfused myocardium look like? Reperfused myocardium, the area which is reperfused is usually hemorrhagic, because when ischemia was there, the blood vessels were damaged and as a result of which the blood leaks out after reperfusion. Microscopically, if you see irreversibly injured myocytes, they will start exhibiting contraction bands. These are intensely eosinophilic stripes. This happens because of exaggerated contraction of the sarcomeres when perfusion is re-established. So again, this is just a kind of what we have seen earlier only. You can see that the function starts going down immediately after permanent occlusion of the vessel, and the viability, though it is still viable till 20 minutes, after that the viability also starts decreasing. If we talk about temporary occlusion and then we have that reperfusion also, you can see that the function has declined, and then as reperfusion was done, the function that is seen in green arrow starts going up. After restoration of flow, the viability which was going down and would have gone down, which is shown by a broken arrow, it is maintained. This is called salvage. There is also something called as reperfusion injury, which limits salvage. We'll see that now. So reperfusion injury, it can trigger deleterious complications including arrhythmias. This is in contradiction to the improvement that we expect under reperfusion. After reperfusion, we saw on gross that hemorrhage happens. This is because the vasculature is injured during ischemia, and after that, as the blood flow is restored, it leaks out. There may be also paradoxically, even after reperfusion, no reflow. This happens because ischemia may cause damage to the microvasculature, which will lead to endothelial swelling and it will occlude the capillaries. So this may limit the reperfusion of critically injured myocardium. So this was about myocardial infarction. We have covered only what is important from the aspect of the subject of pathology. It is a huge topic, and more details you will study in your medicine subject. Just to revise what we have already seen, smoking, blood cholesterol and hypertension along with diabetes mellitus are strongly associated with risk of MI. On ECG, ST segment elevation, it's a characteristic finding. If we talk about markers for myocardial infarction, then cardiac troponin T and I, they are the most sensitive and specific biomarkers. If you talk about reperfusion and salvaging the myocardium, then time is myocardium. As early as the intervention is taken, is done, more amount of myocardium can be saved. Myocardial injury is reversible in first 30 minutes. Reperfusion can be accomplished by thrombolysis, angioplasty and coronary artery bypass graft. So thank you very much for joining Pathology Basics. Hope you enjoyed this talk. If you have really done so, please share it with your friends and colleagues. We are eager to know your point of view, your comments, your suggestions on this. We would also like to know on what topic you would like to hear lectures from us. Please mention that in the comments. Thanks a lot for tuning in.